Last week, a known Filipino exorcist was arrested for allegedly offending the religious feelings of a devotee of Mary, Mediatrix of All Grace. The case stemmed from Father Winston Cabading's remark, debunking the reported Marian apparition in Lipa, Batangas. It was filed by retired Sandiganbayan Justice and former Commission Elections Chair Harriet Demetriou. Cabading slammed the case, saying his explanation is based on documents from the Vatican's Sacred Congregation of the Doctrine of the Faith. Now, does this case have legal basis? To get his thoughts on this, we are joined by former Comelec Chair and one of the framers of the 1987 Constitution, Attorney Christian Monsod. Attorney Monsod, good morning. Welcome back to the program.
Welcome. Thank you for inviting me.
All right, Attorney Monsod, this is quite an interesting case. You have a priest accused of offending religious feelings. So Father Winston Cabading, for the benefit of our viewers, supposedly is a rabid critic of Our Lady Mary, Mediatrix of All Grace, because of some statements rejecting the 1948 apparition of Mary in Lipa, Batangas. The case was filed by Harry Demetriou, a former Comelec Chair like yourself, and a retired Sandiganbayan Justice, who as judge convicted the late Calawan Mayor Antonio Sanchez. So let me first get your thoughts about this. Is there basis to file this case in court?
Well, if you read, I think the first thing we should do is read the Revised Penal Code Section 133, if there is in the first place. And it is it's against anyone, and I read it, who in a place devoted to religious worship or during the celebration of a religious ceremony shall perform acts notoriously offensive to the feelings of the faithful. My understanding is he made these statements in an online interview. It was there was no, it was not in a religious place or on the occasion of a religious service, and it seems to me that the church itself, the bishops and the laity, did not think that he was guilty under 133. It's only former Justice Demetriou seems to have been offended. And if that provision of the law is too overbroad, as to, you know, one person finding it offensive while the rest, even the church itself, does not, that law is unconstitutional. As a matter of fact, there were initiatives before to delete that provision. I think it is in the case of Carlos Celdran, the Office of Solicitor General also suggested its deletion, and that it is unconstitutional. It's a throwback to the age of church intolerance and oppression. So I don't see how the prosecution found probable cause enough to file the case and stand. It's been filed, and there's going to be scheduled a June 1st hearing in court. That it even got there. I'm surprised, even got to that stage.
We'll try to break down your comment, Attorney Monsod, one by one. And let me just go back to that case that was filed. Actually, you referred to the online statement, but there were also statements made during a conference on the Ministry of Spiritual Liberation and Exorcism, not in a church. And it was supposedly a closed door meeting also. But Justice Demetriou was saying there were some ceremonies held. There were supposedly some rituals that were held during that meeting. Will that actually qualify as a religious event or within the contemplation of Article 133?
I don't think so. Qualify for that. I mean, just because it's a meeting with a religious tone and with questions were raised about religious events or dogma does not mean. I don't think that's the coverage of the law. And that's precisely why the law is, many people say it's unconstitutional, should be deleted, because it's so overbroad in the possible interpretation. Actually, if you read, there was a case in 1939, which somebody who did not belong to the Catholic Church used the church premises for a funeral. And the court itself, that those who dissented, Sheikh Laurel and Moran, said that, you know, it's important in things like this, that there should be what they call an unbiased judicial criteria in determining whether a crime was committed. Mm-hmm. It can't be so broad as, you know, anybody can just go there and say, I was offended. And mm-hmm. It's a subjective issue. And therefore it is it should be declared unconstitutional as being too overbroad. I think it's really time to delete that. No? Mm-hmm. In the case of Carlos Celdran, I happened to be there. Mm-hmm. In fact, I testified for him. Mm-hmm. So during a ecclesiastical meeting or services, and there was a lull. Nothing was happening. There was no mass. There was nothing happening. And mm-hmm. I was seated with the bishops. I was invited there. And Carlos Celdran came with a big placard with the word Damaso. Mm-hmm. He didn't say anything. He just stood there. And was, then when somebody came and talked to him and so on, he allowed himself to be led out. But I think at the door of the church, he shouted something like, Damaso, remember Damaso. Mm-hmm. No bishop filed, finding it offensive. It was a layman who filed it, only one. Mm-hmm. I testified for him and I said, I was there. I'm a Catholic. I did not find it offensive. And there was a lull in the services. And as you know, maybe the church, if the church feels that it was really offensive, they can even file a case for damages. Mm-hmm. That's the tenor of a proposal of Senator Lila in 2019, that it's about time to delete it because of these legal reasons. And mm-hmm. the judge convicted Carlos Sedan, and I think it was a miscarriage of justice. He fled to Spain and he died there.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. The offense, Attorney Monsod, offending religious feelings, doesn't it appear to be so arbitrary and really subjective? Because one act might be offensive to one person, but right. It might not be to another. So how is there a uniform basis for saying that one is offensive to a religious feeling?
Well, you know, first of all, there's the word notorious, mm-hmm. offensive. And then the justices in the 1939 case that said that it should be an offense about a religious dogma or mm-hmm. a religious ceremony. Yeah, so that must be offensive, and therefore you're right. There is something wrong with the law because it is too overbroad. It's too overbroad as to cover anything, and where one person who says, "Ah, well, I'm a Catholic, and I find it offensive," and that's a basis for convicting somebody under that provision of the law. Mm-hmm. That law, I think, should really be deleted already.
I'm curious, Attorney Monsod, why it survived this long? Because you're citing a 1939 case. We know that this law dates back to the Spanish Penal Code, 1880s. We already have the 1935 constitutions, where you have the separation of church and state provisions and the non-establishment clause. You would think that we wouldn't have a law like this that would favor established religion. And yet, this law is still there. What happened? Why did the framers of the previous constitutions not think about, or was there any discussion about Article 133 in previous, at least in the 1986 Constitutional Convention?
No, it was not really discussed. I don't remember it having been discussed. Mm-hmm. But obviously, it's archaic. Mm-hmm. It's an archaic law. And as I said, it's a throwback on the period in our history of religious intolerance and persecution. It's no place in our law. Mm-hmm. And in the case of Sheldon, it was about reproductive health law, right? He was staying down. And we were very careful. We even had dialogues with doctors and the bishops about making sure that it does not cover abortifacients. And it does not. It does not. It is. It says that's not one way of family planning, and that law was passed in 2012 or 2013, and yet there were some church people was still objecting to it on family planning, because they were saying, well, you know, in family planning, you should. Every time you have sex, then it should be for the purpose of having a child. And that's beyond the purview of the law. But you can see how it is where people of extreme minds with respect to what is offensive can weaponize this law for their own personal. But even, you know, in this case, even the bishops are supporting Father Cabading and lady organizations. So I don't think it should have been filed in the first place.
You don't think that the courts have a business in looking into whether a certain apparition happened or whether a church teaching is true or not? Is that the matter that's exclusively should be under the province of the churches?
It was supposed to have been a miracle. It was the church who investigated it and said it was not a supernatural thing. The church already said that. Well, I don't think that the courts should go into that. It was a church issue. It was resolved by the church, and I think that the civil government should not get involved in that at all.
One other aspect to this, Attorney Monsod, is Father Cabading was raising his right to freedom of expression. He was merely expressing himself, he said. He was saying his opinions. Now, where do you draw the line between freedom of expression and offending religious feelings? So this is now the intersection of two rights. Is there a hierarchy of these rights? Which one is protected more than the other?
Well, I think the freedom of speech, of expression, and of the press is of a higher level. In fact, it's almost absolute, right? It even applies to prior restraint, because that's very critical to a democracy. So there are many instances in the Constitution where provisions are at tension, right? Like, for example, peace and security and freedom of speech. They're always there. There's no right that's totally absolute. But in this case, I think that it's too overbroad, and it should not have been filed in the first place. The church had already closed the issue as far back as 1950, it happened in 1951, the Lipa supposed apparition. And it's been accepted. For somebody to say now that it was offensive to me, well, offensive to you, but it is not notoriously offended to the faithful.
Lastly, Attorney Monsod, is there a need now to at least amend, update, revise our revised penal code, because it's supposedly a revised penal code, but it was enacted in the 1930s. And many developments have already taken place in the span of almost 100 years. Should we now amend the revised penal code? How urgent is that?
Well, there have been revisions of revised penal code, and we should continuously look at it to say whether it's already archaic or it doesn't apply anymore, or it is, you know, the context and circumstances have changed in the meantime. Of course, that can be amended, and it has been amended.
All right. On that note, thank you so much for sharing insights with us this morning, Attorney Christian Monson.
You're welcome.